other tracks running late. I'm sure people will wander in as they become free from lunch. So thank you all for making the time to be here. My name is Raj Desai. I'm the executive director at TAI. Some of you may have seen me on the opening of the conference. This is the first time that we're hosting an event with this topic on impact investing. And it's certainly, we are very excited about it, and we hope we can get enough of our members engaged and involved because this is a very important aspect to be involved in as you become successful or in whatever business and level at which you are engaging in socially impacting programs is a good thing to be doing. So whilst TAI's focus is about entrepreneurship, I think impact investing is just as important for us, and we want to promote that as we go forward. You know, we have, again, even though it's our first time, we're really, really privileged to have some amazing organizations and speakers representing those organizations here with us. You know, from Lemelson Foundation to Aspen, to Rockefeller, Skoll, U.S. India Endowment Fund, Miracle Foundation, and also the Indus School, that will be the last keynote of the day. So really, these are big names. They're doing very, very you know, big kind of programs and projects. Their vision is global. Implementation is global. And as TAI is a global organization, it is very appropriate for us to engage with them. So with that, I'll not take any more time as we want to try to really give you the meat of the program with these speakers engaged in explaining many of the programs that they're involved in. So with that, I would like to invite Sada Chidambaram. He's our charter member at TAI, an angel investor, successful entrepreneur in his own right, a Silicon Valley tennis player. I'll let him take us to the next session. Thanks so much.
You were all able to hear Ramesh Wadhwani this morning. Amazing. Warren Buffett said that the wealthy and the fortunate should leave his kids enough to do anything, but not enough to do nothing. So taking it from there, today's successful entrepreneurs, including many at TAI, are setting examples of playing ahead, of playing forward. And today's topic is a topic that we are doing for the first time at TAI, impact investments. And the question really is, can social investments indeed be profitable? So our speakers today will share that it must be so in order to make changing lives a sustainable proposition. Our first chat today will be with Lemelson Foundation, which was established by U.S. inventor Jerome Lemelson and his wife back in 1992. The foundation has provided more than $175 million in support of this mission. The Lemelson Foundation uses the power of invention to improve lives by inspiring and enabling the next generation of investors and inventors and invention-based enterprises to promote economic growth in the U.S. as well as social and economic progress for the poor in developing countries. Ladies and gentlemen, my great privilege to present Carol Dahl and Will Poole.
Okay, this is the after-lunch talk. We have to make sure everybody's awake. So that's Carol's and my job here. I'm Will Poole. I'm the co-founder of Unitas Seed Fund. We are a very active impact investor in India. Our office is in Bangalore. A couple of us hang out in Seattle and fly a little bit too much. But the people that do the hard work are based in Bangalore. And we're very pleased to be partners with Lemelson on a variety of things. And so I'm going to lead a little, we forgot to bring the iPad Fire here for our fireside chat. We'll have a little chat between us and then also leave some time for conversation and questions at the end. So let's start. And Carol, Lemelson has been a pioneer in impact investing, I think, for quite a few years. And can you talk a little bit about what, why you got into impact investing and what does it mean to the foundation in terms of your overall mission?
Sure, great. Well, let me start by giving just a little background on the foundation because it sets the stage for why we've gotten involved in this. As mentioned, the foundation is a private family foundation. We're based in Portland, Oregon. And our founder, Jerry Lemelson, was extremely prolific U.S. inventor. Just to give you a sense of how prolific, he had over 600 patents. So that comes out to more than one a month for over 40 years. Pretty stunning. So he knew the power of invention, and he and his wife started the foundation because they believed passionately that we needed to invest in the next generation of inventors and enable them through creating a supporting ecosystem to take their ideas through the innovation process and entrepreneurship into businesses, and that those businesses would not only create products that would improve people's lives, but also create a strong economy. So we focus on two things in terms of our goals. We use the same tool to get there, which is we inspire and educate the next generation of inventors to become inventors, innovators, entrepreneurs, and then we actually help to create an ecosystem that will allow them to launch the businesses. In the U.S., we focus on businesses that are going to do good, but also make a strong U.S. economy for the future, which is something we've, I think, heard about even over the course of this conference. But in addition, we work in the developing countries, and in the developing countries, we focus solely on the problems of the poorest. So we see a huge opportunity for invention and innovation-based businesses to actually address both basic human needs and also help people to lift themselves out of poverty through creating more effective livelihoods for them. So we get involved in impact investing in two ways. One is we're very much focused on creating an ecosystem. So most of our work is actually done through others. We provide support to other groups who actually provide those early stage seed fundings and mentoring to help people move forward. But we also, as Will pointed out, we're early into the space of doing impact investing ourselves using the PRI mechanism. So a program-related investment out of our charitable funds that uses more conventional tools such as loans or equity investments to actually support the companies. We see that even though we're a foundation, we can give grants, we're not looking to get the money back, because our goal is actually to see long-term that there are businesses that are financially stable, producing product and delivering it on a long-term basis. We recognize those businesses cannot be aid-driven. They must have a virtuous business cycle. To get them there, we have to use traditional tools to demonstrate that they're investment worthy by others.
So you mentioned the word sustainability in those businesses, and not everybody would take it for granted that you can build a business that both meets the charitable purpose and is financially sustainable and even profitable or doing really well. So why do you believe in this, and can you talk a little bit about how that works from Lemelson perspective?
So I guess at the Lemelson Foundation, we believe fundamentally that if you are solving a problem that someone else has with a product that actually meets their needs, that then there's going to be a market for that. And so it really comes down to, do you understand the customer well enough to create the solution to their need? And that's where we think invention comes in, because it doesn't necessarily mean it's the same product that you and I have here today. It may have the same functionality, but it may need to take a different form, format, and maybe price point in order to be working in that situation. Certainly, we'll need a different delivery mechanism. So we think that that's possible and doable, and we're beginning to see that with the companies we've invested in. I'll give you a couple of examples. I gave the example that we work in the U.S. There's a company called Ecovative that came from a student-led team. It was given funding, very small amount of funding, from a partner we work with, the National Collegiate Inventors and Innovators Alliance, that actually allowed a company to start up that is now creating products that replace styrofoam and insulation and other types of filler materials that are actually toxic and will be bad for the environment over the long run, with technology for a material that is created from agricultural waste and mycelium of fungus. Sounds strange, but in fact it works, and it's a great product. That company has already gotten follow-on funding of about $14 million, and so it's growing rapidly. It's a great opportunity. In the developing countries, it takes a little bit longer. The problems are harder. The delivery is harder. We see exciting companies coming along. One here that I think multiple people in the room have touched at different points, called Promethean. It's based in India. It started here in the U.S. Once again, we touched it at the point where one of our partners gave it a small student grant. And that student grant allowed them to take it to a company which has now received funding from, for instance, the Indo-US Partnership Endowment, and also received funding from investors, social investors. That company actually works on creating refrigeration technology that can be useful in the rural setting. There's a huge amount of waste and loss of value for smallholder farmers as they bring products into that arena. And so by creating refrigeration systems that can work out in the villages, produce and other things can have more value for the farmer as well as for the distributor. Their first product is actually around milk, and so they have a thermal battery that protects milk refrigeration in rural communities. That way the farmers get good quality milk and prices for it, no matter what time they bring it during the day, even if the truck has just left for the dairy. And the dairy has a better product they're selling, so they're making more money too. Everyone's happy.
So those are two great examples, and we're here at a conference around entrepreneurship, which probably has something to do with both our efforts to build pipeline. Ultimately, you know, we're only able to accomplish the missions through the kind of companies we can find, support, and invest in. So what are things Lemelson does to build and develop the pipeline in the ecosystem?
Right. So we think it's important to start at the beginning. If you want to change an ecosystem, you can't just start and say, you know, where's the company I'm going to invest in? We actually think about ecosystem. So, and I think we'll touch on this during the series of sessions this afternoon, but it really starts with changing the way you think about education to help empower those individuals who are inspired to take on big problems and actually equip them with the tools. They can become inventors, innovators, entrepreneurs, and take that forward. A couple of examples of that I mentioned before here in the U.S., we work with the National Collegiate Inventors and Innovators Alliance. They actually help create institutions of a higher education to actually create programs around invention, innovation, entrepreneurship. And then they actually fund student teams to actually turn into companies and move outside of the academic setting. In an example that we've been doing in partnership in India is the case of Stanford India Biodesign, which is now rolling out companies also of interest. There are a few here, actually, like Contours here at the meeting. And that situation, we provided funding very early on to help take what was a very successful approach that was happening here at Stanford and help make that transition so that it could replicate in India in partnership with the Indian Institute of Medical Sciences and IIT in Delhi. In that case, the kind of support we could provide was there was money in India to actually replicate, but there was no money here. And so we were providing money to Stanford to partner with the institutions in India and actually create what is an educational system which turns out designers, engineers, and inventors that are creating businesses that have high potential to address social need. In addition, I think we need to create an incubation environment that will help nurture those companies. We've been talking about money, but in fact, it's not just money, and it's also about how you create the networks and the partnerships. It's a great set of people in this room who have the potential and may already be involved in doing the mentoring that's needed to help young social entrepreneurs turn something that's just an idea and a passion and a heartfelt mission into a business that can be reliable and sustainable.
So you just mentioned the need for mentor capital along with venture capital and philanthropic capital. What are other bottlenecks or rough patches that you see for the kind of businesses that you like to bring forward in these markets?
Yeah. So I think there are a couple of things that are required. One is we see bottlenecks around getting assistance with mentoring. That's, I would say, almost number one. We hear from companies in many ways that's even more important than the money. But money is a problem, and clearly there needs to be the right kind of money. So what we hear is that there is money for impact investment when the company becomes investment ready. But in fact, frequently, the money that's available is in the wrong form or the wrong size. Companies are having a hard time, from what we hear, finding funding in the sort of $50,000 up to $500,000 or $1 million range. As money is moving into mission and impact investing, the funds seem to be getting larger, and the dollar increments at the beginning stages are getting larger as well. So there's a gap in the middle. In addition, they're finding a hard time getting access to the right kind of funding. So we deal primarily with companies that are creating tangible products, so hardware, whether it's a phototherapy device for a neonatal baby out in a rural community, or creating some kind of renewable energy resource or refrigeration system or something like that. And what they need is capital, working capital. They need loans. And they're having a hard time getting it. So commercial vendors will offer them, if they will even offer them anything, something at the 12 to 15% maybe in India, or at the 20 to 30% we're hearing in Africa, interests, which they can't manage. So folks like ourselves will provide funding at a much lower rate. So money is important. The other thing is they need patience and time and support in other ways. They need an environment that has an ecosystem. So sometimes they need money that's not just investment money. They may need grant money as kind of a corollary to help build the ecosystem around them. So we have seen some of the groups we work with, we may provide equity to one portion of the organization, and they may have a separate organization that's actually creating ecosystem to support future pipeline for themselves. And finally, I would say that we need to ensure, particularly for the hardware-based companies, that they have access to prototyping facilities. We find here, even here in the US, in places even as well-developed as Boston and Silicon Valley, people can't always find access to creating hardware, doing engineering, and also access to the customer base that gives them the input they need to actually make the right product. So three big areas: financing, mentoring, and then also providing them with the kind of facilities that they need for particularly hardware-based companies.
So mentioning going to the hardware-based companies, I believe you were an early investor in D-Light, and they're pretty well known in this area. So can you talk a little bit about what that means to Lemelson and what kind of impact you expect to see with them?
Right. So that's a case where really early stage was involved for us. We D-Light came to us together with the Calvert Foundation because the Calvert Foundation was considering investing in D-Light. For those of you who don't know, how many people don't know D-Light? D-Light creates solar-powered LED systems. There's a huge problem, particularly in rural communities and in urban slums. People are using kerosene and other forms of fossil fuels or candles, et cetera, as their source of lighting. It's very costly. It's not good for your health. Actually creates fumes inside the environment. It causes a lot of health problems. And it's not very affordable. So it's also not safe. So LEDs and solar lighting is really important for making a transition to renewable energy that can reach people in both very poor settings, urban and rural. D-Light creates new hardware, and they actually create distribution systems to reach those people. And at the beginning, they couldn't get money, actually loans, to create the physical lights, even though they knew they had customers waiting. They had equity. They had investments from angels, but they couldn't get a loan. So they went to the Calvert Foundation. Calvert Foundation does do loans, but they found that D-Light didn't meet their criteria. It was still too risky. So Lemelson Foundation provided a small loan, $100,000, through Calvert and with D-Light to actually do first loss on anything that Calvert might lose. And so that was a very important step, and the kind of activity that's very hard to find, and a place where foundations and others who are interested in philanthropic giving can get involved. We did get a return on our loan. Everything came back to us, but what we did was we took the risk at the beginning.
This is a great example of where philanthropy and for-profit impact investing can work hand in hand, and one can't really go forward without the other. That kind of example, so yeah. It's good you've been able to do that.
And it's a great example, because just for those of you who don't know D-Light, D-Light has now reached 30 million people with their lights. They've sold 6 million units, and they're having a tremendous impact. So, you know, something small at the beginning, we're very excited about that. With our money, they might not have gone to the next stage. It's right. The kind of really catalytic impact you can have and change the future. But Will, let me ask you, so you have a seed fund and working in India. Tell me a little bit about what you look for and what you see as the impediments.
Well, you know, we do seed investing, which is hitting exactly the gap that you mentioned earlier. We call it the seed gap, and it's a big problem where people can get good friends and family money that'll help an entrepreneur get going. And there's lots, I don't know, north of $500 million of Series A capital in impact in India waiting to be invested. And there's this pileup of innovation on one side and a lack of seed capital and mentoring and ecosystem support to get them to the point where they can do the scale up. So we look for, first, a great entrepreneur. By far, any venture investor is going to invest in an entrepreneur first and a good team around them. The second thing we're going to look for is the market opportunity and the dynamics in that market. Is it capital intensive? Is it not capital intensive? Is it highly competitive? What's the margin structure? You know, those kind of things, just like any other investor. And then finally, we do look at impact. And we have a very high bar from an impact perspective, as I'm sure you do as well. We look for a company that can have an opportunity to serve at least 100,000 families within the first 5 years when we make our investment. So that means it has to be really scaled, but we don't invest in small ideas or people that don't have big plans.
Yeah. So I gave you a couple examples of companies you thought were interesting. Tell us about some ideas you think can scale.
Yeah, well, actually, I'd love to. We just made one announcement on Tuesday of this week that we're really quite excited about. So it's after lunch, so I'm going to ask everybody who has to stand up if you have taken a ride in an auto rickshaw in India or equivalent place. So please stand up if you've ridden an auto rickshaw. Okay, so not surprisingly, most of the room stands up. Now, I want you to stay standing up if you loved the experience of hailing and negotiating with that auto rick driver. Stay standing up if you love that experience. Is it an Uber-like experience? Was it like Lyft? Yeah, okay. So you can sit down now, thank you. The company we invested in on Tuesday called Mgadi, two interesting entrepreneurs. One is a tech entrepreneur and the other one is a Ashoka fellow and labor organizer. And what they are building is a Uber-like service for auto ricks. There's 5 million auto ricks in India. The people are that drive them are not very well, they don't make much income, they're not well utilized, less than 50% utilization in many cases. So this is a case where they're going to provide a great experience for consumers, and at the same time, these auto drivers are going to make a lot more money. And that's a great social purpose all the way around. That'd be one example. Another company we invested in, they had about 10 early learning centers when we invested in them almost 2 years ago, called Hippocampus Learning Centers. They do low-cost kindergarten, pre-kindergarten education in rural areas for between 150 and 300 rupees a month for that parent, and they make a good margin on that. They now will be serving 6,000 kids this year, this academic year, and it's a tremendous success story of a very low-cost, excellent service provided.
So in a moment, I'm going to open up for questions from either of us. As you see, this wasn't a one-way street. This is a two-way. But I'm going to ask Will while you're thinking of your questions. I've mentioned what I thought were some of the bottlenecks or some of the weaknesses in the ecosystem. Maybe you can tell me what you're seeing.
Well, obviously, we're in the business. I don't need to be self-serving about it, but we're in the business of solving the seed gap problem. So capital is an issue. Also, it's not just equity capital, but also debt capital. And you mentioned what you did for D-Lite, that there's working capital. There's lots of businesses out there that are good potential recipients of debt capital that are not good equity investments because you don't know what the exit would be. So I think that capital issue is one that's definitely there. Another big challenge is distribution, particularly when you're talking about the world of atoms and not electrons. The distribution channels to move those products from where they're manufactured out to the point of need are not there. We looked at a company recently that uses India Post as a way to move impact products out into the rural areas. So distribution is a challenge. And then the final one I'd say is just talent and training and retaining high quality talent to operate in difficult environments as you grow and impact businesses is not easy.
So I saw there was a question. Yeah. Yeah, so I would comment, we work primarily on invention-based. We don't work in that space or haven't seen any that have come across in that space. I don't know if you have others.
I have not seen any to invest in. There's a interesting website that popped up about, I don't know, 18 months ago called I Paid a Bribe. Does anybody know that one? Yeah, which I think is pretty interesting. I think that's more at the consumer level of, you paid off a traffic cop. I haven't heard anybody use that at the governmental level yet. Again, we look, though, at things that are where you can make money. Okay, and so trying to fix corruption in government, as important as that will be in India, I'm not sure what the business model would be for that, personally.
But I would comment that I think actually USAID is so the U.S. Agency for International Development is investing in trying to find ways of doing it, and I think they'd be very excited if they could find things that were related to governance that could be turned into businesses or had useful products.
Yeah. Well, thanks for doing what you're doing. I think both of us are encouraged. What else could you give her advice about?
Are you doing that in a developing country context or in India? So I would comment for all of you who are interested in this space, there's an enormously useful resource, which is the Aspen Network for Development Entrepreneurs. It's called ANDE. And so whether you're an entrepreneur and you're looking for where sources of funding might be, we're sitting up here. But there's a network of people who care about that, people who are interested in building ecosystem that will actually funnel innovation pipeline, create businesses, et cetera. The Aspen Network of Development Entrepreneurs is a great place to start. So if you're working on developing country problems, global development problems, becoming a member of that network is a great place to start because you'll meet people with common interests that you can partner with. No, it's a separate organization. Yeah, it's one of their sub-organizations.
And I'll add one other organization for your radar screen, which is here in San Francisco called Impact Assets. And they are a community foundation. The founder came out of Calvert. And I think nearly $1 million of the investment in my fund actually comes through Impact Assets. So people can make a donation to the community foundation via donor advice fund and then advise that to invest into the impact investment of their choice. And we're one of them that can receive impact funds. That's being done in Seattle through the Seattle Foundation. There's a number of different foundations if people want to make it a donation first and then have it be invested. And also, though, you don't have to make a donation. You can invest straight cash in any different impact opportunities and get a return on your investment.
But I ran into FCRA clearances. So like one entity that I'm trying to invest in Cochin.
Yeah. That's because they're a nonprofit, right? Yeah.
No, they don't have an FCRA. So the receiving
entity does not
have an FCRA.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So that's
probably an out of the room offline discussion, and we could certainly suggest some folks to talk to. Yeah. The timer just went off. I think we're being told it's the end, but I'm glad there's a vigorous discussion and lots of questions. I think both Will and I will be around at the meeting for a little bit, so we're happy to take questions maybe outside the room so the sessions can continue.
Good.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.